أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم
In multiple forums and multiple expressions of the grief. It can't even stay within the four walls of a tradition or a culture. It needs to spread beyond that as well too. It needs to go into the streets. People need to be sharing in the grief. And let me look at the mission and the story and the sacrifice of what happened to Imam Husayn alayhi salam. We see that the grief that is naturally triggered because of that is something that cannot be contained. And on a yearly basis, we have to come back to it and rebuild it and share it with others as well. Imam Husayn alayhi salam, peace be upon him, was the grandson of the best of people who ever walked on this earth. And at his time, he was the best of the people at his time. There was nobody more noble, there was nobody more knowledgeable, there was nobody more perfect than Husayn ibn Ali. He was approximately 57 years old. And a terrible incident took place, which was that the leadership of the nation, the Muslim nation, was handed over to the son of the Khalifa who was about to die, the son of the leader who was about to die. Muawiyah appointed his son as the leader. Imam Husayn alayhi salam saw that this was something that was terrible. It would lead to ultimate destruction of this incredible gift of God which had been given to humanity, which is the religion of Islam, the religion of justice and truth and peace, the religion which gives us a program to be able to connect with the divine. It gives us a way of life that leads us towards perfection. This was being endangered by the leadership of Yazid, the son of Muawiyah. And Imam Husayn alayhi salam knew that it was his religious duty to do whatever it took to stand up against this injustice and to let people know that this is not Islam. This is not true. This is somebody who is abusing this great religion for his own means and purposes. And so begins this tale and journey of sadness. He and his family, his children, the lady folk of his home, his sincere companions, they are forced to leave because otherwise he would be killed in his very home. They make their way towards Mecca from Medina. And in Mecca, he seizes the opportunity to spread his message to all those who are visiting in preparation for the pilgrimage. But when he senses that there is difficulties and it's potentially the case that his blood will be spilled in the holy sanctuary, he sees that it is his duty to leave and not perform his religious duties. And that caravan of a small, relatively small number of people, they say that from 72 to 100 or so individuals, they make their way towards the city of Kufa in modern-day Iraq. And along the way, the army intercepts them. The army of Yazid intercepts them. And eventually, they are forced to alight in a land and a city and a place which is known as Karbala. This is a place in which the sun is baking them overhead. This is a place where they have no access, regular access to water. This is a place where they're forced to pitch their tents and await the fate which is definitely coming to them. And they arrive there on the second day of this month, which is known as Muharram. And for these 8 days, they are there, suffering, under the hot sun, children, women, and the army begins to grow and grow on the other side. Eventually, according to some reports, there are 40,000 of the enemy soldiers who are gathered together. And on the 10th day of the month, we witness the ultimate sacrifice, where not only does every one of the companions give his life fighting the enemies, but all the children and the sons of Husayn, his nephews, his cousins, their children, and even 10 or 12 children under the age of 11 or 12 years old, they also give their lives in this mission of defending the truth and ensuring that this great gift of God will be preserved. But this sacrifice is something that we have to keep alive. It is essential to our very existence. It is essential to making sure that we stay true to the principles of our faith. And I want to come to you now, what are some of the takeaways that you want to get from it? One of them is a realization that what did Imam Husayn alayhi salam stand for? There are some people who say that Imam Husayn alayhi salam, peace be upon him, was a humanitarian. And that he can be counted among the ranks of other humanitarians like Martin Luther King and Rosa Parks and others. While we acknowledge the sacrifice of these individuals, there is something which makes his sacrifice unique above all sacrifices. And that is that Imam Husayn to us represents the perfect example of somebody who is a slave of God. The perfect devout servant and slave of God. Somebody who is acting completely according to those instructions that he had from God. He is somebody who teaches us that if you really want to sacrifice and you want to give something to human beings, the way to do so is by making a connection between you and God, and then you can see what you can do for others. This is very important that Imam Husayn, one of his titles is Abu Abdillah. It is that perfect servant of God who gave everything and saw everything that he had as being a gift of God. Lesson number two is that we need to be willing to challenge the status quo. Imam Husayn alayhi salam was someone who taught us that the principle of justice is universal. There is no compromise when it comes to it. Wherever we're at, whether it be in our personal lives, when it comes to our families, whether it be in our businesses, in our careers, whether it be in our interactions with our neighbors and our friends in the community and the society, whether it be in the political sphere, there is no room for injustice and we can never tolerate injustice. And so every year when we remember this, we look at the world around us and see so many causes for which the spirit of Imam Husayn alayhi salam teaches us that we need to speak out against this, whether it be the suffering of the Rohingya Muslims who are being questioned as to whether they're human beings, whether it be black people in this country and others where, you know, it's not clear whether people even value their lives in some situations, whether it be discrimination of minorities in this country, whether it be occupation of lands by foreign powers who have no right occupying, there's so many examples that we have of that. The third takeaway that I'd like to mention is that Imam Husayn alayhi salam teaches us that we need to not only talk the talk, we need to walk the walk. Imam Husayn alayhi salam teaches us that it's not just a matter of slogans, but rather it's a matter of showing what we believe in our actions as well. One of my teachers once gave an example of this. He said that there was a story that's told. There was a beggar on the street, and there was a wealthy person who came by who had some bread that he had just bought in the bakery. And the beggar was crying because he was so hungry, all he wanted was a piece of bread. The wealthy man sees the beggar with the bread and he feels very sorry for him. His heart breaks. And he comes down and takes a seat next to the beggar and he starts to cry with him. And they have a good crying session together. And when he's done crying, he gets up and he walks away. And the beggar is looking at him and saying that all I wanted was a piece of bread. Thank you for your tears. But I wanted some more, something else other than that as well. These commemorations, even though the crime is essential, it's something which is to propel us into action. What the great family of the Prophet, those noble and pure beings, taught us is that love, true love, is something which is coupled with action. In one tradition, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, the grandson of tells us that convey to our followers our salam, our peace, and let them know that we do not, it's not a family relationship that we have with God. It's not the case that just because the Ahlul Bayt are the Ahlul Bayt, then therefore they're going to be saved. No, it's because of who they, what they stood for and what they acted upon. Then he says that the only way to get close to God is through worshiping Him, through obeying Him, staying away from the sins, observing the commandments. And then he says, whoever obeys Allah and loves us, that person is the one who is close to us. But whoever disobeys Allah, his love will not profit him in any way whatsoever. The ideology of Muawiyah and Yazid was that as long as you have faith in your heart, you're going to be saved. But the ideology of the Ahlul Bayt, Imam Husayn, was that that faith has to be coupled and strengthened through your actions. Through understanding what your practical responsibilities are and acting upon them. And the final takeaway that I just mentioned is that we need to carry forward the mission of Imam Husayn alayhi salam. What his grandson taught us, Imam Sadiq taught us, is that when we greet each other in the situation of mourning, we should do so by saying that may God reward you for your mourning, and may He make you and me among the supporters of those who are going to uprise, I'm paraphrasing here, who are going to uprise with the grandson, meaning Imam Mahdi, ajallahu farjahu sharif. There was a call that Imam Husayn made on that battlefield, which has been famously captured as, is there anybody who is there to come to our assistance? Is there anybody who is going to come and defend the family of the Prophet? That call rings throughout the centuries, and it's a call to action, a call to establishment of a just society. And that is the responsibility that we all have here and today. It's not something that just stops with this procession or the commemorations in our centers, but rather it's a matter of adopting a lifestyle of Imam Husayn and the pure family on a daily basis. It means establishing Husayni families, environments where our children are being taught those values that they need to, and they are being taught what values are contrary to the values of truth and justice that Islam teaches us. It involves adopting the ethics of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. The Ahlul Bayt told us, "Kunu lana zaynan, kunu zaynan lana, wa la takunu shaynan lana." Be adornments to us. Do not be sources of embarrassment to us. In our actions, in our dealings with others, we should be people who attract others to this great man and what he stood for, and this great faith and what he teaches us. When it comes to Karbala, there's so many things that we can do in order to make sure these values are instilled beyond these commemorations and gatherings. We need to work at establishing institutions of purity and justice in Karbala, to be able to raise our children in those type of environments so they can be the helpers of the Imam along with us as well. Finally, I would like to take you to the story of a couple of the incidents that took place on that day. And what we do in order to commemorate the story is that we typically invite you to open your hearts and to see if that natural inclination that you have been greeted with to be able to side with the truth, whether it can be sparked alive when you hear these stories of individuals who gave so much.
Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
They see that on the day of Ashura, Imam Husayn alayhi salam is alone. All of his supporters, one by one, have fallen to the ground. He is ready with his sword, he is on his horse, facing tens of thousands of enemy soldiers. And suddenly this boy rushes to the battlefield, ready to defend his Imam. Imam Husayn asks, who is this boy? How can he be going to the battlefield? Where is his mother? Perhaps she would be not happy if he's going to the battlefield. He turns to his imam and he tells him that my father has given his life for her sake. My mother is the one who has not ordered me to go to the battlefield. She would be so happy if I were able to give the sacrifice. The boy rushes to the field crying out, the messenger of God. Ali and Fatima are his parents. Do you know any peer to him? His light shines like the bright sun in the sky. His whiteness and purity is like the glint of the new moon in the dark night. This boy rushes forward fighting these men, these soldiers. But after all, how much can he do? Finally, the soldiers show no mercy or pity on him. They take the blessed head of this child, they throw it back to the tents of the women. But this is not a source of grief for his mother. She picks it up, she's so proud of the sacrifice of her son. She cries out, Yazid. Finally, I will tell you the story of an enemy commander. His name is Shah. The enemy commander was the one who was the cause of this army of Husayn being forced to camp in Karbala, in a land under the sun, baking hot, without access to water. But he was somebody who had a heart, he had consciousness. He sees Imam Husayn, he sees the values he stands for. And the night before Ashura, he's in a quandary, he is thinking to himself. The next day he knows what is going to meet them. How can I take part in this injustice? How can I possibly take place in slaughtering the pure family? How can I possibly be part of this commission, this life of truth and justice? He cries out, Karbala witnesses one of its most amazing sights. The commander of the enemy army makes his way towards the camp of Husayn. His arms are on his head like a prisoner who is surrendering. He makes his way to Imam Husayn and he says that I am the one who has caused terror to enter into the hearts of the family of the Prophet. Is there any way that I can be forgiven? Husayn is the representation of God's mercy. He tells them that indeed Allah has forgiven you. Holy, without even pausing, he turns his soul. more strong. He now charges at the same army he used part of. He fights so valiantly, but eventually he too falls to the ground. He cries out to his master, peace be upon you, O Muhammad. Imam Husayn, the one who is filled with forgiveness and mercy, rushes to the side of this new soldier of his. He turns to him, and he puts his blessed hand on his face, and he tells him that, O Hur, Hur means the one who is freed. O Hur, you indeed are one who has freed. You are one who has been freed in this world and in the hereafter. Your mother who gave you that meaning name of the one who is free, indeed named you in a correct sort of way. We ask God to accept these efforts from us. We ask Him to make us amongst those who, throughout every moment of our lives, we never forget the mission of Imam Husayn alayhi salam, and that we prepare always for the coming of the reward of our Imam al-Mahdi.